All right, come on, let's stand together and let's worship this morning.
bountiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise.
Turn back praise.
When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say,
blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Gonna go. It is a holiday.
holiday type weekend, so we have lots of people on holiday. So let's remember today when we're worshiping to, when you see familiar faces that are not here, let's lift them up in prayer today. Let's pray that they have safe travels, wherever it is they are, and that relationships are being restored and growing, and fellowship is good, and just that they get as much out of this weekend as they possibly can. Amen? You know, Christmas is coming up.
Woo-hoo!
I thought about that. Just way my brain works, October gets here and I start thinking of Christmas. And because I'm something wrong with me, I start thinking about the financial side of Christmas. And I start thinking about gifts and giving. You ever gotten a present for someone really early and you knew it was the good present? Like you knew they were going to love it? Who's done that before? Show of hands. Are you just like giddy that when they finally get the present? Or are you upset? Are you excited to see them get it? You know, the reason I share that with you is we know what it is to be excited about giving. Because we do it all the time. It's when our heart is right in that giving process, it's a beautiful thing. And we're not thinking about how much it costs us or what we could have done. We're completely immersed in that moment and we're excited with great delight to see the person receive that gift and enjoy that gift. This is the time of worship where we say we worship with our tithes and offering. Because worshiping God includes not just our voices, it's we are living sacrifices, is what the Bible says. So our every essence about us, including our giving. So I want to remind us, Scripture says that God loves a cheerful giver. And we're not passing the offering plates around today. They're in the back corner. We have a deposit box, a little cutout in the wall that you can put that in. But I just want to remind us all that when we get to give back to God. You ever just sat and dwelled on what that's like? And we get to set our hearts on that. And we the same type of excitement we know and experience when we give to those in our world around us that we love. That same thing should be in our hearts when we give to God. And if it's not there, man, repent of that and just say, God, fix my heart. Help me get my fingers off of the things of money and the things that can give me because I love you. And dwell on the salvation we have in Jesus Christ that drives everything. So what brings us here together today is Jesus Christ. If you are a follower of Christ, we have set our hearts on him and we know what we have in him, and now we're worshiping him. And we're going to dig into God's word. Pastor Ian's going to come in today. We're going to continue in Genesis. We're going to lean in, and we're going to let the Holy Spirit teach us and equip us. Because when we leave here, we're going into darkness. Aren't you excited? But when light enters darkness, it has a hard time being darkness, doesn't it? So let's just equip ourselves today. And listen, just know that when we leave here, everywhere we go, our homes, our workplace, even when we're driving, we get to be the light of Christ, the aroma of Christ to everyone that's around us. So today's a big deal. Let's worship well and give him all the praise he deserves, and let's lean in and let's just soak into God's word. Amen. Father, we come before you. Lord, I thank you that although we come in here and we have flesh that is tired, disgruntled, frustrated, lackluster, just we have so many qualities that are not good. And that's because we know your word says, apart from you, O Lord, we have no good thing. But Lord, when our hearts are set on you, the salvation we have in Jesus Christ, Lord, when we invite your Holy Spirit into this place and your presence comes in here, Lord, we know it. We experience it and we're changed by you. And Father, that's what we want to do today. We want to worship you with singing and praise. We want to worship you with giving. We want to worship you with our heart's attention and our mind's attention. Lord, we want to worship you knowing that we're to be living sacrifices. And we want to know what that looks like. And Lord, start putting on our hearts right now the people that you've set in our lives that we can have an impact on this week, that we can let them know about your help us to reflect the light of Christ boldly and richly. Lord, I pray that people would squint when they see us coming because of the magnificent glory and beauty of Christ that reflects off of us. Lord Jesus, we love you. You gave everything for us, your life. We give you our life, Lord God. We follow you, Lord Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Rumors of the Son of Man, stories of a Savior, holiness with human hands, treasure for the traitor. No ear has heard, no eye has seen the image of the Father until heaven came to live with me. Rescue like no other.
teaching some of the younger kids in Sunday school. We were actually talking about the burning bush, and it was for three-year-olds, so it was kind of funny because they just kept saying fire hot, fire hot. But I kept asking them, I said, what happens when there's a fire and something goes in it? And they said, it burns. And the power of that moment with Moses is he's just in that desert. He's wandering around doing the same old, and God showed up. And there was a bush on fire, and it wasn't consumed. And he noticed it, and he stepped up to that bush. And the whole course of history changed that day. And he was just an ordinary man that God created. And he gave every excuse in the book why he couldn't go and why God couldn't use him. And I have to wonder how many, I know I miss a lot of opportunities. But if we just take a moment and step back, how many times is God right there in the midst of a fire and just calling us and saying, hey, I chose you for this moment. We sing a lot of churchy songs, like, Holy Spirit, come fill this place. We just pray the prayers, God, we want you to come into this place. We want you to consume us. But will we be ready for it? Because the name of Jesus can cast away demons. If the presence of God can change just one person enough to reach millions, to protect God's bloodline to bring his son so that I could be here today. I know that I need God every day a little bit more than I needed the day before, because it's scary times. I'm scared bringing my kids up in this world. But I know that God breaks chains, he casts out our fears, and he can change anything beyond what my mind can fathom. In a minute, we're going to be singing about how holy, holy our God is. And I want to encourage you to let him invade this place and acknowledge who he is. Chains fall. Jesus, you change everything. Lives healed, hope found here now. Jesus, you change everything. Chains fall, fear bows here now. Jesus, you change everything. Oh, your glory. Show us your glory. In wonder and surrender we fall down. Show us your glory. Show us your glory. Let every burning heart be holy ground.
Holy, holy, holy Lord.
hope everyone has had a wonderful time here this morning, has enjoyed some coffee and some fellowship, and of course my beloved donuts, which are always tasty. A wonderful thing happened on Friday. Carrie, she texted me and said, "Who wants to get me a donut from Holtz?" And I said, "I will." So I brought home a dozen because, I mean, she said I just wanted one donut, and I got a mixed dozen, and the honey bun could feed a family of four. So I was pretty excited about that. This is not a plug for Holtz, although they are over there in the Walmart shopping center right next to Highway 51. They're open Monday through Saturday. But it is not a plug for Holtz. I get no kickbacks. If only I had stock in donuts, I'd retire. We are at the end of a journey. Almost. Last week, we saw Israel, Jacob, gather his sons together to speak with them. He had an excellent memory, and he gives each son the highlights and lowlights of their lives. In the end, Israel blessed his sons and died. He requested to be buried in the same cave as Abraham and Sarah and Isaac, Rebecca, and Leah. This morning, we'll close out our study in Genesis that began just a few weeks ago on February 18th of 2019. And we will look at the final days of Joseph. So turn to chapter 50 in your Bible to Genesis. I'm guessing y'all knew we were going to be there, eh? So just to prepare you on what is going to happen in these coming weeks. Next week, Pastor Zane will recap chapters 1 through 25. It's still a 40-minute sermon. Don't think it's going to be, you know. I will be out of town, so I'll be watching with my comfies on. Then Pastor Mark will recap chapters 26 through 50. Not the same week. That's the following week. Yeah, that's, yes. I had a pastor friend who he spent, I think he did a 6-week study in Judges. I'm thinking, man, you can get through like the first half of the first chapter in, you know, 6 weeks. So Pastor Zane, the first 25 chapters, Pastor Mark, the second 25, and that will close out October. And then October 25th is the last Sunday in October. We'll be at First Baptist. We'll be First Baptist St. Mary's with Rick Corum. He'll be preaching there, so we'll be there. And then the following Sunday is November 1st, the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. So we'll have a special service Sunday morning, the 1st. And then November 1st in the evening, we'll be here at 5:30, at 6:30. Be here at 5:30, because the way y'all read the clock, some of y'all, it doesn't matter. We tell you 5:30, you ain't gonna be here until 6 anyhow, if I can just be honest with you. 6:30, we'll be here for a prayer service. We'll be joining with First Baptist and St. Mary's and have a prayer service for our nation, because November the 3rd, there's something going on a Tuesday that y'all need to be in prayer for. We are in a fight for religious freedom. We're in a fight for the protection of unborn children. We're in a fight for everything that this nation was founded upon. So if you don't know what I'm talking about, there's an election coming up November the 3rd. In Massachusetts, they just passed a law that says if you died, they'll still count your vote if you voted early. I'm not kidding you. So if you vote early and 3 days later you're killed in a crash, they'll still count your vote. This is off the record. I didn't clear this with Pastor Mark or Pastor Zane, but I am in favor of absentee balloting only and voting in person and showing your ID. Just throw that out there, like it was in the colonial days when I was a kid. You hitch up your horse, you tie it outside the polling place, you go in. Genesis chapter 50, beginning verse 1. Have you got your Bible? How about the rest of you? If you don't have a Bible, share with your neighbor. Verse 1, then Joseph fell on his father's face and wept over him and kissed him. Joseph commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father. So the physicians embalmed Israel. Now 40 days were required for it, for such is the period required for embalming. And the Egyptians wept for him 70 days. When the days of mourning for him were past, Joseph spoke to the household of Pharaoh, saying, if now I have found favor in your sight, please speak to Pharaoh, saying, my father made me swear, saying, behold, I am about to die in my grave, which I dug for myself in the land of Canaan. There you shall bury me. Now, therefore, please let me go up and bury my father, and then I'll return. Pharaoh said, go up and bury your father as he made you swear. So Joseph went up to bury his father, and with him went up all the servants of Pharaoh, the elders of his household, and all the elders of the land of Egypt, and all the household of Joseph and his brothers and his father's household. They left only their little ones and their flocks and their herds in the land of Goshen. There also went up with him both chariots and horsemen, and it was a very great company. When they came to the threshing floor of Atad, which is beyond the Jordan, they lamented there with a very great and sorrowful lamentation. And he observed 7 days mourning for his father. Now when the inhabitants of the land, the Canaanites, saw the mourning at the threshing floor of Atad, they said, this is a grievous mourning for the Egyptians. Therefore it was named Abel Mizraim, which is beyond the Jordan. Thus his sons did for him as he charged them. For his sons carried him to the land of Canaan and buried him in the cave of the field of Machpelah before Mamre, which Abraham had bought along with the field for a burial site from Ephron the Hittite. After he had buried his father, Joseph returned to Egypt, he and his brothers and all who had gone up with him to bury his father. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, what if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong which we did to him? So they sent a message to Joseph saying, your father charged before he died, saying, thus you shall say to Joseph, please forgive, I beg you, the transgression of your brothers and their sin, for they did you wrong. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of God of your forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father. And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also came and fell down before him and said, behold, we are your servants. But Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for am I in God's place? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result to preserve many people alive. So therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. So he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Now Joseph stayed in Egypt, he and his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. Joseph saw the third generation of Ephraim's sons. Also the sons of Machir, the sons of Manasseh, were born on Joseph's knees. Joseph said to his brothers, I'm about to die, but God will surely take care of you and bring you up from this land to the land which he promised on oath to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely take care of you, and you shall carry my bones up from here. So Joseph died at the age of 110 years, and he was embalmed and placed in a coffin in Egypt. Today we are looking at the end of an era. Would you pray with me? Father, we have been journeying through this book of beginnings for many, many months. And Father, I pray that it was as much a blessing to those that heard it as it was to those of us that studied it and preached it. Father, there's so many incredible principles found in this book. Lord, I pray they would not be lost on us or taken for granted. But the promises that you made, Lord, I pray we would always remember. So Lord, open my brain. Help me to preach these words clearly and effectively, that your followers would be blessed by this message and that we would glorify you in all that we think, say, and do. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So following Israel's death, Joseph fell on his father's face and wept over him and kissed him. It demonstrates the depth of love Joseph had for his father. I have been in many cases of announcing the death of someone to loved ones. This is a very common reaction. You get the news that someone has died and the loved ones are overcome with grief. I have seen complete, utter non-caring. I have seen people crumple to the floor. As a chaplain of the police department, I have to make a lot of death notifications. There was one month where I think I had made so many notifications that at the mere sight of me, people started crying. It's like I was the Grim Reaper. It was not a pleasant month. I think I made 6 notifications, the worst being notifying a mother that 2 of her children were killed. One other child was in a hospital in Jacksonville, and her husband was in a different hospital in Jacksonville. Not fun news. No one is prepared for death, no matter how sick you are, no matter how old you are. And this guy was old. I mean, we've got old, and then there are these Old Testament saints that are beyond a century. I heard the radio station announce someone on Friday was 104 years old. That's old. I mean, even for old people, they're like, wow, that is old. I thought I was old. There are people who think I'm old, y'all. One in like 30 years, John, I'll be catching up to you. You're like 85, right? No, John's just, you're not even eligible for Social Security. Which I think you got to be 85 now to draw. Every year, they just keep pushing it to the right. This is a demonstration of Joseph's love for his father. He throws himself on Israel and weeps. He kisses Israel and issues an order. His body needs to be prepared for burial. Joseph commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father. So the physicians embalmed Israel. 40 days were required for it, for such as the period required for embalming. And the Egyptians wept for him 70 days. Embalming was widely used in Egypt in those days. So I took the liberty to download some photographs of embalming off the internet, and I'd like to show them at this. No, we're not going to do that. Embalming is a very interesting process, and the Egyptians believed that they needed to preserve the identity of the body. So they would embalm the body, which included removing all of the fluids in there and replacing it with someone else, and that way it would minimize decay. Rumor on the streets is you can dig up people who are 5, 6, 7 years dead, and they still look like they did at the day of their death because of embalming. Now, here's why they did it. So we had to be able to be recognizable, right, in the afterworld. The Egyptians believed that you needed to be recognizable in the afterworld. So if you're decayed and all rotten, and you've got like your ears are all drooped off, nobody knows who you are. So they embalmed people. Now when that embalming was complete, they wrapped the body in bandages. Around and around. Cloth bandages. You getting the picture? 65 films have been made that include mummies. And all those mummies in those 65 movies came to life. There was the mummy. There was the Mummy Returns. Of course, Revenge of the Mummy. Abbott and Costello, Meet the Mummy. There's a lot of good mummy movies out there, but mummies aren't real. Unless you're in England, there's a lot of mummies over there. The process took 40 days, and the Egyptians wept for Israel 70 days. So likely those 70 days of mourning including the 40 days of embalming. Look at verse 4. When the days of mourning for him were past, Joseph spoke to the household of Pharaoh, saying, if now I found favor in your sight, please speak to Pharaoh, saying, my father made me swear, saying, behold, I'm about to die, and my grave which I dug for self in the land of Canaan, there you shall bury me. Now, therefore, Joseph asked, please let me go up and bury my father, and I'll come back. So he relates the promise. Joseph relates the promise he made to Israel / Jacob. If you're having trouble remembering, Israel is Jacob. They are one and the same. And the scripture uses them both interchangeably. He doesn't speak to Pharaoh, but to his household. And there's some speculation as to why Joseph, who, I mean, he was a big dog in the land. He had an audience with Pharaoh. He knew him. He could have spoken to him himself, but for whatever reason, he did not go. Some think that it was because of Joseph's impurity. After all, he laid on Israel when he was dead, which would make him unclean. There is no clear-cut reason, though. Israel wanted to be buried back in the grave that he had dug for himself back in Canaan. Now, I know what you're thinking. I've been scrutinizing this book, and I've been looking at the videos and watching over and over and over again, and I don't remember anywhere saying that Israel dug a grave for himself. But remember, he had a very special woman in his life whose name was not Rachel. Her name was Leah. Remember, he dug a grave for Leah probably while he was digging. He said, well, you know, I might die one day, so I'm just going to dig one for myself. It was a family plot. You see that if you go down to the cemetery in downtown St. Mary's, you will see that Miss Kelly and Mr. Robert Young are buried in the same plot. John is here, Miss Kelly is here. They're buried right next to each other. You see it all the time. You see people in columbariums. All the ashes are put in the same plot. This is not unusual. So Joseph promises to return to Egypt following Israel's burial. I'll come back. Not surprisingly, Pharaoh said, go, bury your father. I think that Joseph could have asked for whatever he wanted, and I think Pharaoh would have let him go. Verse 7, Joseph went to bury his father, and with him went all the servants of Pharaoh, the elders of his household, all the elders of the land of Egypt, all the household of Joseph and his brothers and his father's household. They left only their little ones and their flocks and their herds in the land of Goshen. There also went up with him both chariots and horsemen. It was a very great company. I mean, when you're talking about a funeral procession, this is a ginormous funeral procession. Basically, if you were able to go to Canaan, you went. The entourage included Pharaoh's servants, the elders of his household, elders from Egypt, all of Joseph's brothers' families. Everybody went. They brought chariots. They brought horsemen. The only thing left behind was the thing that always slows down every single family trip, and that is kids. It is 3 minutes. You're on the road. I need to stop. I told you to go before we left. I went. I have to go again. Parents need to dehydrate their kids prior to any trip. Bring a snack. When I get in that car tomorrow morning, we're leaving, probably early. It'll be dark. We ain't stopping until we need to go to the bathroom. After 60 ounces of coffee, I think I may be able to last to the Welcome Center in South Carolina. I typically am the one that slows it down. At my age, you got to stop frequently. You do. Kids slow you down. They always want things. They pass something. You pass a Dairy Queen, you got to stop and get ice cream. Kids slow you down so they were left behind. Obviously, someone had to take care of the kids. They didn't feed the cows or the goats, so you had to leave some people to care for the kids. But everybody else left. And you know the plan, even though Joseph said, I'm coming back, you know that he was. It's not some, there's no shenanigans going on. He came back because he left all the kids. They left everything back. So the plan was always to come back. And all in all, it was a very great company. When they came to the threshing floor of Atad, which is beyond the Jordan, they lamented there with a very great and sorrowful lamentation. And he observed 7 days mourning for his father. The threshing floor was a circular area. It was large and open. Oxen would trample corn there, so this made a good place for all of Joseph's people to stop and mourn. Today we call this a funeral. It's a time to stop and mourn and grieve for that loved one. They lamented there with a very great and sorrowful lamentation. They mourned, an expression of deep sorrow. They grieved. They were sad at the passing of Jacob. And they mourned for 7 days. This funeral service made such an impact on the Canaanites, they said, "This is a grievous mourning for the Egyptians." Therefore, it was named Abel Mizraim, which is beyond the Jordan. Remember, the people that were mourning were mainly Egyptians. The native people took notice of this. It was probably very strange for the Canaanites to see such a sorrowful demonstration from a Hebrew. I've seen things that surprise me when people die. I have lots of death stories. One of the most surprising one, there were two very, very shocking times where I made death notification. One was, and they typically happen in the middle of the night. For some reason, people do not choose to die on a more hospitable timeline. And I got the call that someone had died. I needed to make the death notification, so I got all the details. I knocked on the door. It was something like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. And I will tell you that I don't know of any other time, a knock in the middle of the night, a phone call in the middle of the night is never good news. Knock on the door. A man comes to the door. I asked for my notification was to the woman. Is she here? Yes, she is. Can you go get her? Sure. She comes out. I say, are you so-and-so? Yes. Do you have a brother named so-and-so? I do. I am sorry to tell you that he was found dead at this place. You never use terms like they've moved on. They've passed on. When I went to chaplain school, they were telling us how to do death notifications. And one of the examples was given was a death notification was being made. And the chaplain went to the person and said, I'm sorry to tell you, your husband has gone on to glory. And the wife said, is that the one on 8th Street or Main Street? Glory is a hospital. No, they've been killed. They have died in a crash. Whatever it is, you have to give the reality of what happened. So I tell, do you know, yes, your brother, I'm sorry he was found dead, whatever I said. And she said, oh, I thought you were here to tell me about my son. And she's like, oh, okay, cool. Said, well, when was the last time that you spoke to your brother? And she and her husband started going down memory lane saying, well, we've been stationed here 2 years, and before that we were in Connecticut 3, and then I think... And as they're thinking, it's like, oh, it's been about 8 years. If you have family, pick up the phone and call them. Talk to them. And I don't care if they're the meanest. Just call them. If it always turns into a fight, then say, hey, I guess we're finished talking for today. I hope you have a nice week. Talk to your brothers and sisters. If you've got parents still living, call them. If you've got grandparents living, call them. Go see them. Spend time on the phone if you live in separate places. And by all means, if you live in the same town, invite them over once in a while. Can you imagine? Your brother is dead. Yeah, I just talked to him 8 years ago. I think Reagan was president. It ought not to be, and especially it ought not to be in the church. We have so many different ways that we can communicate. Send them a text, but a text doesn't replace the phone call. Call. Jacob's dying wish was to be buried in Canaan. Verse 12 says, thus his sons did for him as he had charged them, for his sons carried him to the land of Canaan and buried him in the cave of the field of Machpelah before Mamre, which Abraham had bought along with a field for a burial site from Ephron the Hittite. You remember that story? After he had buried his father, Joseph returned to Egypt, he and his brothers and all who had gone with him to bury his father. Dying wishes fulfilled, he is laid in the same cave as Abraham and Sarah were buried in. Isaac is also there. Rebekah's there. So is Leah. The family is reunited in death. Now everybody who went goes back to Egypt. But things are still a bit uneasy. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong which we did to him?" Now, isn't this interesting? The brothers are talking amongst themselves, and Joseph is not there. They're saying they're what-ifing. What if this happened? They've got to be some of the most paranoid people in Scripture. And there are people that what-if themselves to death. Don't live in what-if land. Don't live in if-only land. Don't do that. Once time has passed. You can't get back what happened yesterday. So don't sweat it. Move forward. If only Camden had ridden his bicycle. If only my friend Kevin had gone to the doctor when he first started feeling ill. If only I had never learned to drive. I mean, you can what if yourself. What if I'd never got married? What if I hadn't done this? If only I had listened to my parents. Students, that's always applicable. If only. What if Joseph takes revenge on us? We know their character, don't we? We know these brothers. And we know Joseph's character. The brothers know Joseph's character, yet they think there may be some kind of retribution. They think Joseph might be holding a grudge. I mean, that is a long grudge. The grudge they fear. Now, there's been no indication, but they fear it could bring back some really bad stuff on them. And I will tell you, there has been ample opportunity, if Joseph wanted to do something, plenty of time for Joseph to do it. But all Joseph has ever shown them was love and compassion. The brothers' fear of retribution is another example of how they knew they did wrong to Joseph. They knew it. And I don't even think they really had to look deep down. I think they knew it on the surface. I don't think we can say, you know how we do dumb things to one another as kids. I don't think we can chalk this up to youthful ignorance. They just didn't know any better. I don't think we can do that. Even though Joseph's demonstrated his godly character over and over and over again, the brothers concoct a scheme to protect themselves because they are living in what-if land. In their mind, Jacob, who is now dead, is the only reason that Joseph had not retaliated to this point. But now that Jacob is dead, the protective hand of their father is gone. Verse 16, so they sent a message to Joseph saying, "Your father charged before he died, saying, 'Thus you shall say to Joseph,'" this is from Jacob's mouth supposedly, "'Please forgive, I beg you, the transgression of your brothers and their sin, for they did you wrong. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father.' And Joseph wept when they spoke to him." Notice the brothers say, "Your father." Hey, Joseph, your dad said, "We need to do this." He didn't say, "Our father." He didn't say dad. Now, I know you moms and dads at home, your first name is mom. Your first name is mom or dad. Never does Elisa say something to Jude, hey, go talk to your father about this. She'll say, go talk to dad about it. So this is really strange language. It seems they're exerting the authority of the father, just like when Elisa says, dad says, I'm in charge. Savannah says, Cameron, you have to listen because I am in charge, so you have to do what I say. And never once is that the intention when mom and dad leave and they say, okay, you're in charge. That doesn't mean that, hey, Camden, go clean my room. Camden, go wax my car. Jude, go fold my socks. That's not how it works. You're supposed to listen to the one that's put in charge. So it seems that they chalk this up to Jacob so that they can get Joseph to do what they want to do on a story they made up, because they're afraid that Joseph is carrying a grudge that he had 20 years to act on. They're fearful. So they tell Joseph that dad says, you better forgive us for the sin that we did against you. So is this message really from Jacob? I don't know. It seems possible for sure. But we know the siblings. We know all the brothers' character. I don't know. It says the brothers, did they fabricate the message? If Jacob truly wanted Joseph to know this, wasn't it Jacob who got all the brothers together, all the boys together, and said, hey, you're a chucklehead, you did this great, you're a doofus? I mean, he lists the whole thing. Why didn't he say, hey, y'all get out of here. Joseph, I want to have a private conversation with you. Why didn't he, if this really came from Jacob, why didn't he tell Joseph before he died? He knew he was dying. He said, come gather around. My time for dying is close. So it seems that Jacob had an opportunity. So if it really was him, why didn't he just tell Joseph himself? So the brothers sent a message to Joseph. Again, why didn't they go in person? Hey, Joseph, you got a minute in your busy schedule of saving the world, of providing for our families and all of our kids and livestock? Can you carve out some time in your busy schedule? Now, do you think that Joseph, the brothers would have had to do that to Joseph? No. Remember when the whole thing about them coming in front of Joseph the first time, he recognized them and he wept. He was so excited to see them. But remember, he kept his cool because he wanted to go through it systematically. He loved his brothers, I believe. So why didn't they go to him in person? The message of forgiveness was given to Joseph with a plea of humility. Please. Just like your kids, when they want something, you know. They come to you all lovey. Maybe they give you a hug. Oh, I love you so much, Dad. And see, dads are smart. The thought is immediately, what do you want? You never just come up randomly and give me a kiss, hug me, and tell me I love you. Dads know, and guess what? Moms know, too, because dads typically say, yeah, whatever you want, go talk to mom. And the mom says, what's your dad say? He said it's up to you, but he's in favor of it. All lies. So what you should do is, oh, if dad said that, we'll wait till dad comes home, and we'll have a family meeting. No, no, no need for that. It's okay. I'll just make do. We'll figure something out. So they say, please, pretty please. The always popular, and this works every time, pretty please with sugar on top. I never understood that. Well, I guess sugar makes everything better. It, I guess, sweetens the deal, as it were. If that works on you, parents, I will say, just not to be mean, but I think you're a failure. If you say no and they say, oh no, pretty please. Oh, well, since you say pretty please, then that's fine. Pretty please, yes, that always works. And then if you say no, pretty please, you can pretty please all day long. And then they say, oh, wait a minute. I was reserving this for something really, really special. Pretty please with sugar on top. Oh, since you said the sugar, you half me. Whatever you want, up to half of my kingdom is yours. That doesn't work. Neither does laying on the floor at Walmart, kicking and screaming. So, Dad, stop doing that. Or if you're at, what's the big store that all the guys like to go to? They sell guns and... But the Bass Pro Shop, guys, if you're laying on the floor at the Bass Pro Shop, it will not work. If you're at the gun store kicking and screaming, it won't work. You got to use the pretty please with sugar on top. That works. So they fabricate this whole thing. Please, I beg you. Were they truly sorry for what they had done to Joseph over the years? Or were they sorry because they got caught? They add, all right, so they've, please, I beg you, now, here comes the sugar, and now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father. The God of your father, if you remember back from chapter 46, that's the same phrase used when God spoke to Jacob in a dream, telling him to go to Egypt. I mean, these guys are slick. I mean, they're pulling out all the stops. And we see this happen too. This is an appeal to Joseph's desire to serve God faithfully. Some people have used this with you. They call on your profession of faith in Christ for you to do something they want you to do. If you really are a Christian, then... this. And now in today's climate is if you really are a Christian, then you'll vote this way, or you'll vote this way, or you'll support this, or you won't support this. And we try to tie it to our faith. When nowhere in Scripture do we see any believer being encouraged to follow human authority. We submit to human authority because all authority comes from God. But we're supposed to submit to the principles of Scripture. We're supposed to submit to the fundamentals of our faith and not waver. I do not know how an active follower of Christ can support murdering babies before they have been born. And people even say, well, I am a Catholic. I believe in abortion. I don't see how you can reconcile that. I just saw that there is a minister of a church running for Senate that says, my biblical values support abortion. I don't get it. So know what you should believe, and the foundation is Scripture. And a lot of things that we are supposed to believe or not believe have nothing to do with Scripture. So know what you believe. Don't be, I think it was Vice President Pence that said, I am not something along the lines of, I am not ashamed to say I am pro-life. I heard someone else say, oh, only Christians only care about life before it's born. We don't care anything about life like Breonna Taylor. Now, I'm not going to get all political on you, but all life is important to God. Every life that has ever been conceived is precious in the sight of God, is made in the image of the one and only Son. All lives are, in fact, important, but that message is lost because of the social because of the cultural area where because of the cultural climate that we're in. That cultural climate has to do with social media. It has to do with the media that we see on TV that's filling our brains with stuff that just simply ain't true. It comes with people believing what they want to believe aside from facts. Maybe you heard about the Abraham Lincoln quote in the vice presidential debate that is simply a lie. And it's been fact-checked over and over again. And, you know, you see on Facebook all the fact-checkers. If you got all the facts, why don't you write a book? Tell us what to believe. But no, it's facts based on circumstances. No, the truth is the truth, and it's unchanging. Don't be ashamed to stand up for biblical truth. And if you can't defend it, you know what? You can say, you know, I know I believe in the sanctity of human life. I know that it's important. I know the Bible talks about it, but I can't give you 37 verses to support it. Okay, when you go home, do some studying. It's not enough for you to say, well, Pastor Ian says life is very important, and you should really like life, because Pastor Ian says so. Do you know who I am? Nobody. Who cares what I say? Well, except for this, you know, 40 minutes this morning. But the rest of the time, who cares? You need to know what you believe, and you need to be able to defend it, and don't apologize for it. Don't worry what people think, because no matter what you say, they already have formed their opinion about you. What you say really doesn't matter. So speak the truth. You have opportunity, and you can talk to people that I will never be able to talk to, because I don't live where you live. I don't have the same friends that you have, the same family, same coworkers, the same students. You have an incredible opportunity right now to be a voice for God. And if you say, well, God doesn't need my voice, then why did he give you a voice? God is a majority. So just share what he says. We know Joseph heard the humble request from what's supposed to be his father. Verse 17 says, Joseph wept when they spoke to him. He was so moved. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, behold, we are your servants. I am certain that this verse is not lost on you. When we think back to young teenage Joseph, when he told his dreams to his brothers in chapter 37:7, the brothers said, are you actually going to reign over us? Or are you really going to rule over us? That was just, now you talk about patience and God's timing, that was 22 years ago. And I don't think Joseph was rubbing his hands together for 22 years saying, just you wait, you bunch of jerk brothers. I don't think he was doing that. I think he was serving the Lord. I don't think he was looking in the past. I think God provided opportunities, and I think Joseph followed the opportunities God provided. His brothers fell down before him and declared their servitude. Behold, we are your servants. Joseph, I mean, here you talk about payback right now. Here's the time. Here it comes, right? Well, we've read already to the end of the chapter, so you know what happens. But he could have done a number of things. Could have thrown him in jail. Could have thrown him in a pit. Could have sold him to some Midianite traders. He could have done a number of things. He could have refused to give them grain and let them starve to death right in front of his eyes. He could have said, I told you so. But we don't see him doing any of that. In fact, all of the things Joseph could have done to demonstrate his power, and yet he says in verse 19, do not be afraid, for am I in God's place? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive. So therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. So he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Is that the words of a vengeful man, or are those the words of a man that truly loves his brothers, that loves God? Now, these verses, I know, have become some of the most popular cliched verses to use about God's sovereignty. Some speak with certainty about what God's will is and claim the superiority and finality of God's sovereignty. Now, I can tell you without question, I know what God's will is for you in certain areas. God wants you to pray without ceasing. God wants you to abstain from all immorality, abstain from the very appearance of evil. God wants you to study your Bible. God wants you to rejoice in all things. God wants you to love your neighbor as yourself. God wants you to love him with all your heart, mind, and soul. Those are things that apply universally to all believers. But what is God's will for your life as an individual? I have no idea. The problem with the view of the superiority of God's sovereignty is that it depends on a wrong definition. There are those that even elevate God's sovereignty as his ultimate power. But that power would require others to exercise control over things. So before creation, this attribute of sovereignty did not exist. Omnipotence is an eternal attribute. It's not dependent on anything. God is absolutely in control, but he is not controlling. There are those that you know that say God must be the orchestrator of sin because everything that happens is a result of God's will. So sin in the garden was a result of God's will. God really wanted to send Jesus to the cross. That was his will. Because it's his will, it's going to be done. If I slap you in the face, that happened because it's God's will. God does not need sin to accomplish his will. There's a difference between God's permissive will, me slapping you in the face, and God's perfect will. He doesn't want me to sin. He never wants me to sin. He wants me to live life sinless. He doesn't need my sin to make his will come about. Well, Joseph, what happened to Joseph? That's what God wanted. No, it's not. God didn't want Adam and Eve to sin, but he allowed it to happen. God is not the orchestrator of sin. And if you think he is, you have a wrong understanding of Scripture. You have a wrong understanding of the definitions that we have in Scripture. God's sovereignty is important, but you have to balance it with God's love and his character and all the other important qualities that God has. He is in control, but he's not controlling. He did not force me to put this shirt on this morning. And there are people that believe that everything that happens, that's God's will. I haven't worn this shirt in a while, and I try to rotate through my clothes. Am I the only one saying like that? You rotate? Now, in the old days, I would wear an outfit, and I would pull it from here, wear it, then I'd put it here. Let them roll down the line. But now I color coordinate everything, which is normal. And godly. And holy. Am I the only one that has a spiritual gift of organization? I'd like to know where my stuff is. But some people will say that. It was God's will for me to wear this shirt. I think he probably likes this shirt. But in the realm of his care, I don't think he... I mean, he's not thinking, man, Ian really looks bad up there on the thing. But if he wears that shirt, he'll look good. I don't think he cares. And I know it sounds silly and trivial, but there are people who hang their hat on God is in control of every single thing that happens. That means everybody who is murdered, a crime is committed, sin is committed. That's what God wants in order to get glory. Didn't Paul say, grace is a wonderful thing, and if we want to show how awesome God is by his grace, should we sin more and more to show God's grace abound? Wouldn't it, Paul has said, no, no, 1,000 times no, don't ever do that. God gets glory by us being sinless. And if we could live a life free of sin, what would be the ultimate glory? But no, we're in this body of flesh. He doesn't want us to sin. He understands and knows we will, but he doesn't want us to ever sin. And I believe that you have the power to not sin if you are wholly devoted to God every single second of the day. Now, I'm not talking that that's a easy thing. There are some days maybe there are some minutes that I do really good. And then Zane comes in my office. And he says, hey, I just got a phone call about whatever. It's like, oh, my goodness. Oh, it would be great if we were awesome for God every single second of the day. And that should be our goal. Be holy, for I am holy. Rightly defined, sovereignty means supreme power or authority. We should then understand God's sovereignty to mean that he has the right to rule over his creation. Now, we speak of sovereign nations, don't we? The United States is a sovereign nation. Nations have the right to rule over themselves. It would be nonsensical to think that since the United States is a sovereign nation, that everything that happens in this nation is because the government is in control. Now, there are a lot of dumb, bad things that happen because the government is in control. But not everything happens in this nation is because we have 3 branches of government. There are those that equate God's sovereignty to his control, and that simply is not true. You only need to look at a few verses to disprove that. Psalm 115:3 says, but our God is in the heavens. He does whatever he pleases. Psalm 115:16 says, the heavens are the heavens of the Lord, but the earth has given over to the sons of man. God has given man a level of independence to choose what he will or will not do. Can God stop you? If you are walking in front of a school bus, can he stop you? Yes! There are times where people trying to commit suicide, there's a bullet in the chamber, they pull the trigger and nothing happens. God can intervene. And there are miracles walking about this planet when God has intervened. Jesus told his disciples to pray to God that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So to me, I'm not the smartest guy around, but that tells me that God's will is not done on earth. And Jesus is praying, hey, disciples, pray like this, that God's will be done on earth just like his will is done in heaven. If everything is carefully orchestrated by God, then prayer is useless. Why pray if everything is already orchestrated? Why don't we just step back and get out of the way? But if you keep reading after Genesis, there's a book called Exodus. And there is a phrase repeated in Exodus that says, but for the prayers of Moses, prayer changes things. God's will, I will admit to you, is a very, very mysterious thing. Joseph's character shines brightly through all this adversary that God allowed in his life. Joseph's brothers intended to hurt him, to do evil to him, to make life miserable for him. But Joseph focused on what was good, on what was holy, on what was pure. Sometimes you have to walk, Becky, through the fire that God has set before you. Becky mentioned it, didn't even know unless she went into my office and stole my notes. Sometimes God allows you to walk through the fire, and sometimes the fire extinguisher is on the other side of the fire. And there's no way to get around it but through the fire. You ever walk through your house, middle of the night, in the dark? You don't need to turn a light on because you know the path. You know the path of safety because you know what the path is, whether it's lit or dark. You know what the path is. That's why you don't want your wife rearranging the furniture. Our furniture has been the same way since we moved in the house. There's a reason for that. I walked through the house. I know the path. If you know the path God has for you, you don't need the light, because we walk by faith, not by sight. Joseph's faithfulness to God allowed him to be in a position to save the world from starvation. There's no possible way for Joseph to have orchestrated what happened in Canaan in Egypt. Just like there was no way possible that Jesus could have chosen to be born in Bethlehem. Had it not been for Joseph's obedience, what would have become of the inhabitants of that area? What would have become of Joseph's father and his brothers? So Joseph tells his brothers, look, I am going to take care of you. I'll take care of your little ones. And I love how this section ends. So he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. A real life demonstration of a heart devoted to God. The kind of love that can only come as a result of God's love in him. The evil that was done to Joseph at the hands of his own brothers is unspeakable, but God has overcome that evil. Point number two. I'm just joking, nurse. This is, we are at the end. Verse 22, Joseph stayed in Egypt, he and his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. Joseph saw the third generation of Ephraim's sons. The sons of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were born on Joseph's knees. Joseph said to his brothers, I'm about to die, but God will surely take care of you and bring you up from this land to the land which he promised on oath to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely take care of you, and you shall carry my bones up from here. Joseph died. He was 110 years old, and he was embalmed and placed in a coffin in Egypt. He has been in Egypt some 80 years, and he has experienced so much. He saw the third generation of his son Ephraim. That's the great-great-grandchildren. He breaks the news to his brothers that he's about to die and assures them that God will take care of them. He reminds them of the promises, the promise to take them out of Egypt and return to the land of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the first time in Scripture where the patriarchs are used. But he does make his brothers promise to carry his bones up from Egypt. Genesis ends by saying Joseph died at 110 and he was embalmed and placed in a coffin in Egypt. And like Jacob, Jacob and Joseph, the only people embalmed, the only two biblical characters to undergo embalming. One day Joseph will make the journey back to Egypt, but you will have to read about that on your own. We have come to the end of the beginning. We walk through the creation. All that we know was created, including the stars, planets, birds, animals, and the first humans. We met Adam and Eve, and we saw sin enter the world. We learned of the curse of sin and the promise of one that would be sent to redeem humanity. We saw humanity descend into unspeakable evil, except for Noah, a man that was found faithful. We saw the flood come, and we saw Noah and his family saved from the flood and saw his family repopulate the earth. We see the scattering of the people. Abraham and Isaac come onto the scene. Then Jacob and Joseph. Twists and turns, scheming and plotting, conniving, tragedy and triumph. And we find it all in this incredible book of beginnings. Will you pray with me? Father, we have come to the end of this journey in this book, but not quite yet. Lord, I pray and thank you for all that we have learned in the last nearly year and a half or more as we've studied this book. Lord, it has been so incredible. So, Father, I pray that you would help us with this biblical foundation, this biblical firsts, so we can know how things really did begin. We can answer those questions that always seem to plague people. So, Father, I pray as always that as these words that we have heard, that we have studied throughout the months, Lord, help us to apply it to our lives, that you would be glorified in us and through us. In Jesus' name.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in
it is a long weekend. Are we having men to men, women to women tomorrow night? Do we? None? Okay, I wasn't sure. So no men to men or women to women tomorrow night, but Wednesday night we are having Awana. We'll be, everything else will be running as normal this week other than tomorrow night. I have no clue. Youth tonight. So any other announcements anybody need to make? Ian made a lot of announcements this morning in his message, so we know what's already coming in coming weeks. All right, well, let's pray. Father, we are so amazed at your goodness, how wonderful you truly are. And God, it is just a joy to journey this life as your people, knowing that nothing can come our way that is not filtered through the hands of a loving Father. Lord, even when the enemy launches assaults against us, Lord, when people treat us wrong, sin against us, Lord, all those things, the evil that is meant against us, Lord, you can.